Peace, Hotep Islam. Today is October 8th, 2013. It's Canaan Land Moors class. The European knows what's up, do you? Because it's still, you know, we're still battling out here, getting the word out to our people that they're not Negro, Black, Colored, or Ethiopian. That these names were given to slaves by slaveholders in 1779, lasted until 1865. And it's 2013 now, and you know, we're still trying to get this message to our people. And a lot of it is hard because there's people on our side, right? There's people who are so-called, you know, conscious, Afrocentric, etc., right? That put out information about our people from that de facto, artificial, fake position, right? So the work is hard, but it's work that we do because this is about a people getting back what they lost, right? This is not about going to some European to beg them to give us something, right? This movement, this level of information that Moors present is to get our people out of the slave brand mind state, because the slave brand mind state is what creates the slave brand, right? They had to get us to think that we're Black people for us to call ourselves Black people. They had to get us to think that we're African, think that we're slaves, to get us to call ourselves these things. So today's class, we're gonna go to the European authors, right? Just authors out there, right? Europeans who put information out to show our people that they know. So when we talk about, you know, Moors have a situation, right? Let's say Moore reserves his rights on something, and then he goes to the person that gave him that contract, and they're saying that they don't want to accept that so-called signature because, you know, we can't make it out because, you know, you put too much stuff on there, so you have to change that. You know, and people come with the perspective of, well, they don't recognize it, that's why they did that. That's a wrong perspective, right? The reason why they did that is because they're gatekeepers, and their job is to stop you from exercising your rights. That's why they put stupid people, or that's why they put zombies at the front gate, because you could tell them whatever and they're not hearing anything that you're saying. Why? Because they're a zombie, right? Just like when you look at the movies or whatever, zombie is not concerned about anything other than getting you down with the zombie movement, and they'll do anything that they have to do to get you down with the zombie movement, right? So keep in mind, as we go through this stuff, that the Europeans, these European authors or whatever, they're familiar with everything that the Moors talk about, right? They're very familiar, right? And they're putting out the information for the people that study, for the people that read, for the people that aren't in the mind state of Negro, Black, Colored people. That's why we see so many Europeans at Stonehenge and we're not there, right? And if we are there, we're not there in our proper status. We're there because, you know, this is a brilliant idea by these Europeans to come out here and, you know, worship the stars and, you know, watch the solstice and equinox and all these things, astrology and astronomy, when really that's our sciences that they're taking and they're using, right? So we're gonna start today with, because we got a lot to go over today. So we're gonna start with the Book of Life, the Book of Law, excuse me, by Aleister Crowley, right? The Book of Law. I remember this is, European occultist devil worshiper, right? Page 9. The Law of Thelma. Thelma is the Greek for will and has the same numerical value as agape, the Greek for love. This book lays down a simple code of conduct. Do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. Do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. Love is the law. Love under will. There is no law beyond do what thou wilt. This means that each of us stars is to move on our true orbit as marked out by the nature of our position, the law of our growth, the impulse of our past experiences. All events are equally lawful and everyone necessary in the long run for all of us in theory. But in practice, only one act is lawful for each one of us at any given moment. Therefore, duty consists in determining to experience the right event from one moment of consciousness to another. Each action or motion is an act of love, the uniting with one or another part of Nuit. Each such act must be under will, chosen so as to fulfill and not to thwart the true nature of the being concerned. The technical methods of achieving this are to be studied in magic or acquired by personal instruction from the Master Therion and his appointed assistants. The New Aeon. The third chapter of the book is difficult to understand and may be very repugnant to many people born before the date of the book, April 1904. It tells us the characteristics of the period on which we are now entered. Superficially, they appear appalling. We see some of them already with terrifying clarity, but fear not. It explains that certain vast stars or aggregates of experience may be described as gods. One of these is a charge of the destinies of this planet for periods of 2,000 years. The moment of change from one period to another is technically called the equinox of the gods. In the history of the world, as far as we know accurately, are three such gods: Isis, the mother, when the universe was conceived as simple nourishment drawn directly from her. This period is marked by matriarchal government. Next, beginning 500 BC, Osiris, the father, when the universe was imagined as catastrophic love, death, resurrection, as the method by which experience was built up. This corresponds to the patriarchal systems. Now, Horus, the child, in which we come to perceive events as a continual growth partaking in its elements of both these methods, and not to be overcome by circumstance. This present period involves the recognition of the individual as the unit of society. We realize ourselves as explained in the first paragraphs of this essay. Every event, including death, is only one more accretion to our experience, free-willed by ourselves from the beginning and therefore also predestined. This god Horus has a technical title, Heru Ra Ha, a combination of twin gods, Ra Hor Kuit and Hor Par Krat. So R A H O O R K-H-U-I-T and H-O-O-R-P-A-A-R K-R-A-A-T. The meaning of this doctrine must be studied in magic. He is symbolized as a hawk-headed god enthroned. He rules the present period of 2,000 years, beginning in 1904. Everywhere his government is taking root. Observe for yourselves the decay of the sense of sin, the growth of innocence and irresponsibility, the strange modifications of the reproductive instinct with a tendency to become bisexual or epicene, the childlike confidence in progress combined with nightmare fear of catastrophe, against which we are yet half unwilling to take precautions. Consider the outcrop of dictatorships, only possible when moral growth is in its earliest stages, and the prevalence of infantile cults like communism, fascism, pacifism, health crazes. Occultism is nearly all its forms, religions, sentimentalized to the point of practical extinction. Consider the popularity of the cinema, the wireless, the football pools, the guessing competitions, all devices for soothing fractious infants, no seed of purpose in them. Consider sport, the babyish enthusiasms and rages which it excites, whole nations disturbed by disputes between boys. Consider war, the atrocities which occur daily and leave us unmoved and hardly worried. We are children. How this new eon of Horus will develop, how the child will grow up, these are for us to determine. Growing up ourselves in the way of the law of Thelma under the enlightened guidance of the Master Therion. Right? So that's the Book of Law, Aleister Crowley. Okay? And everything that he's talking about in there is more science. Everything that he's talking about in there is the so-called studies of Kemet, studies of ancient Egyptian culture, whatever, right? That we want to call it, right? So even in the schools of thought that they tell our people to stray away from because it's demonic and devilish or you know, not in their best interest because they're going to be sinners, they're talking about their culture, right? And remember that when you're doing research for more, like, you know, especially new Moors coming out, when you're doing research and you bump into information dealing with Egypt, ancient Egypt, Kemet, Kush, Nubia, etc., remember that all that fell. So it doesn't make sense even naming those things and places anymore. All that fell, right? And when all that fell, all that Egyptian Nubian culture, when all that fell, the Moors were the custodians of that culture. That's a documented fact, right? So logically, we're going to take on from the point where the transition was made, right? We're going to take over and we're going to move forward from the point of the transition. We're not going to go back and try to wake up the dead, right? We're going to move forward, just like with knowledge of self. You get knowledge of self, you're moving on from that point forward. You're not going back after you know that there's worms in pork. You don't go eat pork after you find that out, right? That's counterproductive, okay? Now, this is the YMCA directory, right? And this is, talks about the YMCAs all across the world, right? Now this book right here is 213 pages, right? And it talks about places from A to Z where there's a YMCA in the world, right? And keep in mind, this is not new, right? This is not new. This is a pretty old book, right? So and as well, this is for all those people who, you know, who are so-called conscious people, right? But you know, they are going to YMCA to go give them fiat, but then when the time for community something happens, and you know what I mean, we need community assistance, you know, the conscious people, you know, all of a sudden your time's hard and they don't got money to go to support and whatever like that, this is for those people, right? I like to go to the gym and look, you know, buff in their RBG gear, right? But they're not in the park or whatever. They have membership in YMCA in these places, right? But specifically YMCA in this case. This is the official emblem of the World Alliance of YMCAs, adopted in 1881, which focuses on the open Bible and the motto of the movement, that they all may be one. John 17, verse 21. And the first two letters of the Greek word for Christ. The YMCA emblem, most widely known, is the red triangle, symbolizing equal development of the body, mind, and spirit. More recently, the World Alliance has been using a modern design of the official emblem, which incorporates the triangle. Right? And this is the symbol of the YMCA. Right? Chiro. And the Chiro is said to have connections to Constantine and the Greeks and all these, you know, European perspectives, when really the Chiro goes right back to our ancient sciences of astronomy, cosmology, etc. And the symbol of the Chiro, that X with the P, is really the solar ecliptic path and the celestial equator, right? So they're taking our universal science, right, and they're using it, and they're creating all these myths to say that it's theirs. You know, Constantine had a dream about this because, you know, they needed a symbol in order for them to go to war, and they needed a protection sigil, and Constantine had a dream about this, and then they took this and they put it on all the shields of the army, and then they went into battle and they won the battle, and they say it's because of this symbol why they won the battle, because, you know, divine intervention helped the Romans win. And right, all that is BS that they started creating in order to push their so-called doctrine of Christianity or Catholicism or whatever you want to call it. It's all the same thing. All the three houses of religion all comes from the popes. So it's nature worship or pope worship. And according to this, the popes worshipped the universe. They didn't worship the Jesus and Mary. They worship nature. Right? And again, for all those Moors out there, right, this is not being used in the perspective of Moor science. This is being used in perspective of the theft, right? And this is YMCA symbol. So just keep in mind, when you go to YMCA, you're pumping weights, that all those fees that you're paying to have a membership, you're supporting the popes of Rome. Right, just remember that. Right. The history of Spain and Portugal, William C. Atkinson. You know, you could, just one of those little books that, you know, they used to have just on the, in high school, on the library rack. You know, the little rack by the side. They say, you take these books, we don't want them anymore. This is one of those books right there. Right. Page 155. Political problems, on the other hand, Philip honestly believed he did understand. Such was the question of the Moriscos of Granada, whose forced conversion in 1502 had not led to their expected full assimilation into the Catholic fold. Half a century later, they remain still suspect not merely of attachment to their earlier faith and practices, but of a close understanding with the Turks, whose almost undisputed control of the Mediterranean ever since Charles' discomfiture at Algiers in 1541 gave substance to very real fears that the revanche was at last at hand for the Catalan adventure into the Near East over two centuries earlier. More than once, Charles had proposed a radical uprooting of the Moriscos from the setting of their Muslim past, but this prosperous community, knowing his financial straits, had each time bought him off, and Philip's ascension found them still wearing Moorish dress, still talking Arabic, and still Muslims at heart. In 1567, Philip renewed the ban on Muslim practices and the Moriscos, convinced at length that the son was of different stuff from his father, finally confirmed much of what he had been alleged against by the launching open rebellion. Right? So under occupation, right, the Muslims, and oh yeah, for all the new Moors that are coming into the fold, whenever you're doing your historical research and you bump into information talking about Moriscos, Granada, Algiers, Morocco, Saracens, Berbers, right, etc., they're talking about Moors in code, right? And just like today, right, even though the Moors were under occupation in Spain, even though they were under occupation, they were under a foreign jurisdiction at the time, and they tried to force them to convert to Catholicism, right? Philip's accession found them still wearing Moorish dress, still talking Arabic, and still Muslims at heart, right? In older books, that would also say Muslims, which also means Moors, okay? And speaking about Muslims, just to cut for a sec, somebody posted something online about 8-year-old brides or whatever being taken by Muslim men and them suffering internal bleeding or whatever from these marriages that they have 8-year-old girls doing in Muslim culture. Let me put it out there so everybody knows. Moors aren't Muslims. Don't even try to, I know Seti and all these guys, they like to fabricate things, right? So don't let these guys convince you that Moors are down with stuff that Muslims do, because you might see a Moor do Salat, or you know, he might be reading a Quran, or you know, whatever. Don't even equate the two, right? We're Moorish American, right? We'll say Muslims of the West, you know, Islam to Shikran. We'll say Muslims of the West, just so you don't tie us to the East ones, because the East ones, they're raping little girls in marriages and stuff like that, and we don't get down with that, right? So know that there's a brick wall in the sand between Muslims, M-U-S-L-I-M-S, and Muslims of the West, which are the Moors, right? This rising of the Al-Pujaras of 1568-70 had it enjoyed full instead of merely token support from Islam could have preluded another collapse of Christian Spain. For the might of this empire, on which the sun never set, of this monarch whose will, it has been said, counted for more than the will of any other man in the world, was so widely dispersed as to be nowhere strong and was perhaps weakest of all at home. Troops were hastily summoned back from Italy, and eventually, after a campaign sullied with the utmost cruelty, the king's half-brother, Don John of Austria, smothered the outbreak. The Moriscos were deported en masse from the province of Granada and scattered throughout Spain, and 12,000 peasant families from north moved in to take their place. Right? So this was the real deal behind the expulsion of the Moors. The real deal behind the expulsion of the Moors was for the European peasants of the world who didn't have anything, right? Because remember, during this time, the kings and queens of Europe, they had, you know, paper slippers, and you know, their clothes were made out of rags and stuff like that. Don't be fooled by these pictures, paintings, or whatever that they're showing people about kings and queens of Europe. They didn't have anything. You do your own research and see that they were poor, right? They had nothing. They had zero, right? No language, nothing like that, right? So this process of expansion, right? And you know, when you go into the history of our people in the areas that's quote unquote considered Europe, you'll find out that we ruled there. So if we ruled there, that means that there was no such thing as us conquering those places as they talk about, right? Because they'll tell you that the Moors conquered some places, right? But if we ruled there, that's not conquering, right? And then the people who are conquering, right? Because they're the ones writing the history, they're saying that they're discovering stuff, and that we're pagans, and that they're holy men. Right, all of this is part of the game to get you to not accept your Moorish culture, on top of them calling all these different names, and we're sitting there scratching our head like, damn, there's all these people on the planet when it's just dark skin people that they just named all these different names and try to get us to accept the fact that we are not who our ancient foremothers and forefathers were, when that's far from the truth, right? Another one of those books sitting on the rack in the library, you know, take these books. These books are out of print and we don't want them anymore, and they just roll the rack out to the front of the library and people could just take books for free, right? So this is the world living religions by Jeffrey Parinder, right? Jeffrey Parinder, a reader, a comparative study, religion educator at the university, blah blah, right? Uh, 1964, published by Pan Books, right? And there's Jeffrey right there, so you could see, you know, this is the enemy, the devil that created all the problems that we have right now, right? Page 18. The Arabs entered Egypt in 640. So already right there, when they say Arabs, they're talking about Moors. Just for all the new people, right? that hear all these terms, and it's so many terms, you know, which one is really us, all of them. So as anytime you hear Arabs, somebody say Arabs, don't put in your mind what you see in Saudi Arabia and all these places today, Turks and all that. Don't get that out of your mind. Put yourself in your mind when you read about 640 and they talking about Arabs, right? The Arabs entered Egypt in 640. Alexandria fell and the Byzantine armies and fleet were defeated, right? An old libel that the Arabs destroyed the famous Library of Alexandria is without any foundation. Many of the inhabitants of Syria and Egypt were Christians, as was the Byzantine Empire officially, but they welcomed the arrival of the Arabs, for they were groaning under the Byzantine yoke. Arab rule was generally mild, for they were not experienced in the government of great states, and were glad to leave it in the hands of local officials under the direction of emirs who were responsible to the caliph. Christians were rarely persecuted, but over the centuries, the weight of Muslim rule led to the disappearance of all the Christian communities in North Africa, with the exception of the small Coptic Egyptian church in Egypt and Ethiopia. Omar was murdered by a Persian slave in 644, and after some debate, Othman, a weak man, and another Meccan was made caliph. On the credit side, Othman had the official version of the Quran prepared by a secretary, Zayed, and several others, but there were many intrigues against him, and a band of Arabs set out on a holy war against Medina. Othman was killed while praying, and his widow sent his hand to his cousin Muawiyah, who was a ruler of Syria. Ali was elected caliph in Medina, but the prophet's wife Aisha led an army against him, and Muawiyah forced a compromise by which he was called caliph in the west and Ali in the east. Right, and then we're just going there, just so you know, because they say, you know, the invasion, or, you know, us coming into Spain in 1492 was the first occurrence of the Moors going into Europe, when they're telling you right here that the Arabs entered Egypt in 640. And again, we're not talking about pale people, right, that we see today that run those areas, right? And this is just stuff that's out there. The World's Living Religions. Jeffrey Parinder. Right. Orders of the Great Work. Orders of the Great Work. Alchemy. Manly P. Hall. Okay. Just get a little close up so we can see what Hermetica is about. Right? So do your research on Hermetica and you'll be clear. Right? Page 10. The later Egyptians believed that alchemy was revealed to mankind by the god Thoth, lord of the mind and secretary of nature. Thoth emerged as the initiate priest king Hermes Trismegistus, or the thrice great, the thrice greatest. Very little is known about this obscure adept, who has been honored as the founder of the Hermetic arts. It is a moot question in the minds of many historians as to whether he really existed as a great philosopher, or whether he was a symbolic personification of a secret doctrine of chemistry guarded by the priests of the Egyptian mysteries. For centuries, the term Hermetic has been confused with alchemy or magic. Actually, the Hermetic art is theurgy, the science of the perfection of man through internal illumination. Most of the alchemical writers of the medieval period refer to the old legends as true and faithful reports, but proof is completely lacking. Scarcely any of the illustrious prophets and sages of old times are omitted from the traditional lists of philosophic chemists. Numerous books, presumably by these remote authors, were circulated throughout Europe, the Near East, and North Africa. No, not South Africa, East Africa, West Africa, North Africa, where you already know, everybody knows, that's the dominion of the Moors. We are justified in assuming that references to any extraordinary antiquity for alchemistical speculation should be regarded as allegorical or fabulous rather than literal. Even the origin of the word alchemy is disputed. The prefix al suggests an Arabic source, and the Arabs, especially the mystic sects which flourished among them, were enthusiastic exponents of the art. The second syllable, chemi, is reminiscent of Egyptian chem and the hieroglyphic khmi, which signifies dark earth and by extension simply darkness or blackness. So right there, Manly P. Hall is telling you that the origin of alchemy is a mix of Arabian and Egyptian. Isn't that Moors? Isn't that the same thing that George G.M. James is saying? That there was actually a connection between these two people? That's the only reason that the Egyptians would trust the Moors with all the mystery systems and the sciences. Because they were the only ones that were trustworthy. Why? Because they're family. So we're going to give you everything that we have, because we know that you're going to take something and do something with it that only you can do with it. Nobody else received that blessing. And it's very strange that when we do our research about that transition, only few places, the most known place that it comes up is George G.M. James' Stolen Legacy, right? And for those who don't know, word is that he got killed for that book, for that particular point, bringing up the Moors. And it's not far-fetched, because they killed Khalid because he said that he was a Moor. They killed El Hajj because he nationalized. They killed, you could say that they killed Dr. York because he's pretty much 700 years or whatever he's doing, right? Jeff Fort, right? Chief Malik. Killed him, they buried him, right? You know, and you know, if you get life in prison, they killed you, right? They don't have to put a gun to your head, because they understand the impact that certain people have, right? They understand the influence that certain people have. And the best thing to do is get certain people out of circulation, right? So that the people don't have access to them. But this is specifically why Noble Drew Ali made the statement, study, study, study. So we have more adepts, and it's not as easy for them to pinpoint who the leader is and take them out, because everybody has leader knowledge. So once we all have leader knowledge, once we all study, 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 right? And when we say study, 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 right, we must be clear that studying, studying, studying has to start with having a Moorish mindset. You're going to study, study, study as a black guy because you're going to be all over the place. There's going to be no path for you to follow. You're just going to be walking in tall grass, right? You know, no cutlass or nothing, just walking in tall grass. Right, Same thing with the Negro perspective. Same thing with the African mindset, Egyptian mindset, the Kemetic mindset, the sovereign mindset, right? If you don't have nationality and birthrights in your mind before you start study, then you're going to be lost, guaranteed, right? All authors refer to alchemy as the science of the Egyptians, the dark or hidden art. It is not unreasonable, therefore, that the Egyptian word chemi, K-H-M-I, could have given us our modern word chemistry, and that the prefix al, forming alchemistry or alchemy, properly means God chemistry or divine chemistry, or generally the divine art. The basic axiom of alchemy is that man perfects nature through art. Art is the wisdom to know and the skill to do. Right? Art is the wisdom to know and the skill to do. Okay? So when Moors say, I'm Moorish American and that's it, and they don't do anything else but know that they're Moors and go to the temple and sit there and go home and read their Quran and go to the temple and sit there and ask a question, and that's not art, right? That's just you just going through the motions because, you know, that's it. But with knowledge, or when you know, knowing is practicing the skill to do something. If you know something, if you know how to talk, then you better be doing that. If you know how to read, then you better be doing that. If you know, that's giving you the skill to do. So if we know thyself, we know that we're Moors, then we should be doing as Moors do. Not talking about, you know, whose school of thought is right, because every school of thought is Moors. Every school of thought that we say are for is for the redemption of our people is really and truly an aspect or an offshoot of Moorish science. Every single one of them. Right, all of them. Go ask, if you ask the right Hebrew Israelite, they'll show you a nationality card. If you find the right Hebrew Israelite, they'll show you a nationality card and tell you that Nobu Drew Ali is their prophet. If you find the right Nuwapian, they'll show you a nationality card, and they'll tell you that Malachi York is Malachi Zadok L. And they'll tell you that they honor the prophet Nobu Drew Ali. Right? Guaranteed. I mean, and I'm saying that because I know they're out there, because I know them. Right? And high honors to them. Right? If you find a so-called black Jew, there's black Jews out there, 2013. They have nationality cards. And they push nationality and birthrights and Prophet Nobu Drew Ali. Right? They're not in talking about Tree of Life and Torah and all that. They have a Circle 7. Right? There's Rastafarians who know about His Imperial Majesty and, you know, opening of the seven seals, and, you know, Emperor of Ethiopia, Negus, Negas, you know, power of the Trinity and all that. That they have Circle 7. And they study Moorish science and Nobu Drew Ali. And they're connecting these dots. So don't be fooled because you hear people in these groups don't talk about Nobu Drew Ali. Means that that's consensus with all of them. That's not, all of them don't have that perspective. There's little splinter splinters of individuals in all these groups out here that say that therefore the redemption of so-called black people, that they have nationality cards and they're studying more science, and they have to do that in secret because they'll get ousted. The little organization that they belong to, right? I'm not gonna say no names. I know somebody right now, like right now, that they're part of organization, right? And they're coming into the information about more science, and people are mad because they're quoting and quoting and unquoting black when they use it, and telling them why are they doing that? You know what I mean? That they're black people, and why can't they accept that they're black and all that stuff? And they don't want to hear anything about Moors in their organization. Right now, there's people dealing on that level, right? And that's their own people. That's not the European. That's their own pushing that on them, right? Robert Anton Wilson, the thing that ate the Constitution. Right? And this whole book is about democracy takeover, basically, of your republic, the European. I'm just going to read a quote. H.L. Mencken, M-E-N-C-K-E-N, quote, "The most dangerous man to any government is the man who is able to think things out for himself without regard to the prevailing superstitions and taboos. Almost inevitably, he comes to the conclusion that the government he lives under is dishonest, insane, and intolerable." Okay? And that's the thing that ate the Constitution. Very interesting book. Right? Very, very interesting book. Right? What is happening in the United States right now to human freedom and to the Constitution that was written to secure and protect your liberty? Why does the U.S. have a drug czar who proudly destroys millions of lives and bullies the government of the rest of the world into prosecuting an insane war on drugs? How did a Nazi spy come to have an enormous influence on current U.S. foreign policy? Will the war on terrorism put the last nail in the coffin of your rights? Will Hannibal Lecter make a better president than George W. Bush? Bob's keen wit skewers those who are forcing us all into slavery and warns us that there is little time left. How long will it be before Bob's books are banned as literary terrorism? Right? Oh yeah, and then the European got his book published by New Falcon Publishing. And you already know that's a Hey Rubert right there. Right? You know. But then when we go to all these black authors, right? Their books aren't published by publications that have any type of mental connection to where they are. Right? Majority of those people's books, they're published by some individual who in secret's a Mason. Right? Now, this next one. This book right here, first published 1978, right? This was a book that I believe my aunt or somebody bought it for me, right? And we're looking at, like, I'm 38, so we're talking about this book's like 20 something years old or something like that, more than that. Right, this book's probably about 30 years old, right? And it's called Here's More, Tell Me Why: Enlightening Answers to Questions Children Ask by Arkady Leokam. Arkady Leokum. Right. Illustrations by Frank Alouise. Right. Page 69. How old is the game of draughts? Right, checkers. Two of the oldest games played by man are chess and checkers. They are related in some ways, but since checkers is simpler in form, it is assumed that it came first. Checkers was played in early history of Egypt, which means it's at least 5,000 years old. Plato and Homer mentioned the game of checkers in their works, so it was known in ancient Greece. The Romans are believed to have taken the game from the Greeks. The early records of this game seem to indicate that the kind of board used was similar to what we use today, and that it was played with 12 men on each side. The first book of checkers was published in Spain in 1547. In 1620, another book of draughts was published in Spain that contained sample games and traps that would still be useful to know today. It is believed that the Spaniards may have learned the game from the Moors, who brought it from Arabia. In England, the first book appeared in 1756. In 1800, another book by a man called Joshua Sturges became a guidebook for playing checkers that everyone followed for more than 50 years. Today it's played by millions of people all over the world, etc., etc. Right? And we know, right? We know, based on this European's book right here, page 70, that the Spaniards may have learned about checkers from the Moors, who brought it from Arabia. Right? So the concept of board games even comes from the Moors, and we all grew up playing board games. We all grew up playing board games, thinking that that wasn't practicing our culture. Right? When that was directly practicing our culture, because we are the ancient foremothers and forefathers back here today, right? So that one was, here's more, tell me why, right? Here's more, tell me why. Okay, crazy. Just books and books today, Morris, so just bear with me a little. All right. W.B. Crow, A History of Magic, Witchcraft, and Occultism. A History of Magic, Witchcraft, and Occultism, right? And then don't forget, go look up all these authors so you can see that they're European, so that they know your culture, right? And there we go right there. We were talking about last week with Anton, with Aleister Crowley, right? That's how so-called occultists rep the Morris Star, right? If you see occultists repping the Morris Star like this, know that they have some high level knowledge. They're not dealing with the regular, you know, draw a pentagram on the ground and all that. They're dealing with more science. Okay, as soon as you see somebody that claims to be occult, but they're repping the Baphomet goat head star in its upright position, know for a fact, right? Know for a fact that that's not an occultist. That's somebody that's studying more science. right? And they're out there. Trust me, they're out there. Right? And this is what they know, the occult guys, who everybody's saying, you know, don't listen to them. Right? No remains of early Paleolithic man have been found in the American continent. Mankind entered the New World at a relatively late date. The first arrivals, apart from Eskimos, are estimated to have entered the continent between 13,000 and 18,000 BC. They are generally considered to have come in through the Bering Strait, which then may have been crossed by a land bridge. Writers in occult, however, believe that they came from Atlantis, a fabulous continent in the Atlantic Ocean, of which the West Indies are supposed to represent the last surviving remains. They spread all over both North and South America and reach Patagonia, where human remains estimated 3,000 to 5,400 years old have been found. The great majority of these people, for they no doubt came in several waves, had reached its Neolithic and probably the Heliolithic stages. The fact that many were hunters over most of these continents does not distract from that. They would not be able to cultivate except in places suitable for cultivation. If they had come through Siberia, they would have passed through a large region unstable for cultivation. And the same applies to much of the American continent. As a matter of fact, over 40 plants were cultivated by the natives at that time of the arrival of the first white men. Some 20 of these intensively, and one, the maize, is the most completely modified of all cereals, being the only one that cannot live at all without the hand of man. Since the arrival of the whites, no additions to the list of cultivated plants were made, except possibly gayul, G-U-A-Y-U-L-E. The list itself includes such important things as potato, manioc, pineapples, avocado, artichoke, peanut, lima beans, kidney beans, squash, pumpkin, chocolate, India rubber, quinine, cocaine, tobacco, maple, pecans, Brazil nuts, and sarsaparilla. Now, the magic of the Redskins is, over much of the continent, very similar to what we have described in our discussion of shamanism and in some places involving totemism. But in three areas, it developed into a complex civilization, even more extraordinary in many aspects than that of ancient Egypt, although it apparently lasted a much shorter time. Right? Always telling you, making the connection, right? The occult people. The occult people always make a connection between Atlantis and the people of Atlantis and the people of North, South, Central America. Always. It's a theme in their writings. It's a theme in their writings that the high scientists, the high occultists, the witch doctors, the shamans, whatever they call them, were Aboriginal and Indigenous people. Right? Aboriginal and Indigenous people. And the Aboriginal and Indigenous people concept and perspective, it's not about the Redskins and the who looks like whatever. all that's just like with when you see Arab. When you see Arab in writings dealing with not even ancient history, 500, 600, 700, 1,000, whatever years ago. Just like with indigenous people, don't believe the Redskin story, right? Because if you go and you check the Washington Redskins logo, especially the old ones, is brown. They're not a Redskin Indian. These are brown people. And the brown people are the actual aboriginals and indigenous people, right? This is copyright 1968. So since 68, they're telling you about Atlantis and that all the people in the Caribbean, right, all the people in the so-called West Indies, those islands are leftovers of Atlantis. This is a European telling you this. The European is telling you that all the people who claim to be from the West Indies, they're aboriginal and indigenous to the Americas, because Atlantis was attached to America. Right? So since we're talking about indigenous people, let's just quickly read a couple articles of the Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People that everybody, you know, is, you know, pissing on Obama when he signed all these, which means that they endorse what I'm about to read and they're down with it. And the only thing that prevents them from recognizing whether you're really down with it or are you fronting is this information connected to your spirit? Because don't forget, they study more science. So they know when they see you, when they hear you, when they smell you, they know whether you have everything going on properly up here or you just, you know, heard somebody say something, you know, you heard somebody get off some charges by going into court and saying whatever, and you know they know that you're front. Because if this information isn't part of you, if this information isn't embraced by you, right, you will cause yourself a disservice. Because there's nothing else. We did everything. We did the black thing, it didn't work. Right, we're still here. We did the Negro thing, we did the African thing, we did the metaphysic thing, we did the Kabbalah thing, we did the Hebrew thing, we did the sovereignty thing, we did the Pan-African thing, we did the Rastafarian thing, we did the gods on earth thing, we did all these different things. We did the Buddhist thing, we tried the Hindu thing, we go and get henna and all this type of stuff. We are going back to my culture and get henna. Right, and all these things not working. Right, we're still in the same condition, maybe worse conditions. Right, and when it comes to Moorish history, right, understanding the law, even though we know we never did that yet, we never tried that route yet, we're still not going there. And everybody in the entire world, the whole earth plane, everybody on the earth plane, every single individual that has breath of life in them are waiting to see what these individuals are going to do. But they're only going to wait so long because as you see, China's buying Detroit, right? China's buying Detroit. But in order for them to buy, somebody has to sell. Who's selling? And it's not the Aboriginal and Indigenous people that's selling. Right? Part 1. Article 1. indigenous people have the right to the full and effective enjoyment of all human rights and fundamental freedoms recognized in the Charter of the United Nations, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and international human rights law. Now, don't forget, this is not something that the United Nations created. They didn't create these rights for indigenous people. These are rights that are part of the indigenous people's culture that they have access to. But the only way that it has any validity is if it's done. Right? The only way it has any validity, right, is if it's done. Once again, when we go to Aleister Crowley, each action or motion is an act of love, the uniting with one or another part. Each such act must be under will, chosen so as to fulfill and not to thwart the true nature of the being concerned. So we have to do with this. We have to do, we have to exercise with this. This is not get this information, sit on it. This is what Nobuju Ali said, take your places amongst the affairs of men. But in order to take our place amongst the affairs of men, we must understand the affairs of men. And when we understand the affairs of men, then we have a better perspective of how we're supposed to take our place. And the only way we're going to understand the affairs of men is to study the affairs of men. And all the affairs, all the men came together and said that all these affairs that we've adopted, in order for us to even say that we're men, we're going to put it out there in declaration so everybody has access to these, so everybody knows what they are. Right? Article 2. Indigenous individuals and peoples are free and equal to all other individuals and peoples in dignity and rights, and have the right to be free from any kind of adverse discrimination, in particular that based on their indigenous origin or identity. Right? And automatically, the new people are going to look at all the negative things that are going on and say, well, they're not honoring Article 2. Because I see people call themselves Moors and they're not free from any kind of adverse discrimination. Right? And you're right, they're not free from any adverse discrimination, because it's not discrimination. It's really, don't even let these guys get a word out, because we can't let other people know. We can't let other people know that these, even though they put them out there, right? We can't let other people know that these proclamations are in the public for their consideration. People just have to look at these as, you know, just, you know, some international documents that have nothing to do with them. Don't read them. When everything is in here. Right? And not only is everything in here that the international community agrees on, but everything's in here that Nobuju Ali came and told the Moors that they have. And nobody's considering it. Right? Except active Moors. Right? Article 3. As well. I was talking with me and Sister Azawa were building on the Moors' perspective of internet. surveillance. And, oh, well, you know, I don't want to say, you know, why aren't you active? Well, because, you know, when I go online, you know, I don't want to say too much because CIA is, and anything I say can and will be used against me. Well, we came to the conclusion that if there's so-called privacy with regard to your information, and these people that run the internet are going to come and say, we have evidence of you that we got offline, of you doing something or saying something that can be, you know, perceived as whatever, your next thing to them is anything you say kind of will be used against you too, because that information is my private property. And more than likely, they're using that information against you because you're saying something right, not because you're doing something wrong. But they're going to use people who stand up for rights as martyrs in order to deter other people. Say it all the time. As soon as you start getting active, they're going to attack you. This is not a say that you're Moors and, you know, all these people. Some of them, yeah, some of them would bow, kiss your feet and all that when you tell them that you're Moors. But some of them, they're about to take your head, because there was no way that you're supposed to find this out. No way you're supposed to find out that they've been gaming you for 600 years, talking that you came over here on a slave ship. Right? Gaming you. When there's all these international communities that all came together, right, and put these declarations out there, and the most supreme violators of human rights in Earth, on Earth, in the universe, is Canada and United States, and they signed on to this now. So nobody can escape right now. Everybody's bound right now, right, to universal law and order. Everybody's bound to universal law and order. And the question is, are the masters of the universe going to stand up? Or are they going to stay slaves of the universe? Right? Article 3. Indigenous people have the right to self-determination. By virtue of that right, they are free to determine their political status and freely pursue their economic, social, and cultural development. Article 4. Indigenous people have the right to maintain and strengthen their distinct political, economic, social, and cultural characteristics, as well as their distinct political, economic, social, and cultural life of the state. Article 5. Every indigenous individual has the right to a nationality. Article 6. Indigenous people have the collective right to live in freedom, peace, and security as distinct people, and to full guarantees against genocide or any other act of violence, including the removal of indigenous children from their families and communities under any pretext. In addition, they have the individual rights to life, physical and mental integrity, liberty, and security of a person. Right? So indigenous people have the collective right. Now recognize, right? Recognize that all the times before, it said that indigenous people have the right to. Indigenous people and individuals have the right to. Indigenous people have the right to. Indigenous people have the right to. Right? Article 6, right after Article 5, which deals with nationality, it starts talking about now indigenous people have a collective right. Because the collective right is exercised through a body politic. The people on the reserve, they don't have a collective right. They're slaves. on a plantation called a reserve. They don't have the collective right of anything, right? Okay. And so what you're going to do is you're going to go through those international, and remember, the UN declarations aren't giving you rights. The UN declarations are only acknowledging that these certain rights exist to the people, and it's up to the people to exercise them. If the people don't want to exercise them, cool, no problem. That's up to you, right? But it would be in the best interest of the people to exercise their rights. Okay. You're gonna go out and you're gonna get copyright 1981 by Michael H. Brown. Brown's Lawsuit Cookbook, How to Sue and Win. Now remember that we're not going to be going out there to go sue a de facto corporation, right? Because they're bankrupt and insolvent, and there's nothing for you to get if you sue them. So get out of your head that, oh, they violated me, so I'm going to sue. Like, they have nothing to give you. You're suing in gold and silver. 1933, they suspended the gold standard and stole all the gold. So there's no gold for them to pay you if you sue them. Right? So what you're going to be using the Brown's Lawsuit Cookbook for is to learn how to write writs. Right? You could also go on RV Bay Publications and Moorish Nation Public Records website and just download the writs and study those. But this is going into processes of the court and things of that nature, right? Page 6. Actually, okay, yeah. So page 5. The federal system is a classic example of how not to do things. Federal judges are appointed for life, supposedly in order to keep them from bowing to political pressures, to preserve the integrity of the judiciary, to keep them free from corruption, etc. Unfortunately, such a program has exactly the opposite effect. What happens is that federal judges, inhabiting a position that it takes to satchel of dynamite to dislodge them from, can become unbelievably arrogant and totally irresponsible. You'll learn more and how to cope with them later in this book. Ironically, at the very moment I was writing these lines, my secretary came in with my November 10th, 1980, volume 3, number 9 copy of the National Law Journal. So gonna do some research on that. The National Law Journal. On the cover is an article about a federal judge in Cleveland named Frank Battisti, who is busily at the moment cramming forced busing down everyone's throat. He is a classic case of rule by lawyers, and it's typical. Appointed to the bench by President Kennedy, a member of the executive branch of government, mandated forced busing on Cleveland citizens, a legislative function. Forced busing was never a law passed by Congress. Took over the Cleveland School Board, an executive function at the state level. Federal judges arrogating power to themselves, the Constitution or the Congress, never intended, has been fairly common since Andrew Jackson's term in office. It should be obvious to a child that the only way to stop this nonsense is to make a federal judgeship an elective office, the way we do it in the state judgeships here in Kentucky. Of course, that would leave the political parties nowhere to dump their political and legal dinosaurs. Which brings us back to the legal dinosaurs, the lawyers. To do battle with an opposing side on a lawsuit and a lawyer or lawyers on it, keep one thing in mind. Law is not a discipline like chemistry or physics. It does not require the years of training that, for example, a good machinist or mechanic must have. It is merely a collection of index paragraphs, just like you would find in a comprehensive set of encyclopedias, written in plain English and presided over by personalities, judges, and men who have an incredibly exaggerated opinion of their own intelligence, lawyers. Right? So we'll go again. Law is not a discipline like chemistry or physics. It does not require the years of training that, for example, a good machinist or mechanic must have. It is merely a collection of index paragraphs, just like you would find in a comprehensive set of encyclopedias, written in plain English and presided over by personalities, judges, and men who have an incredibly exaggerated opinion of their own intelligence. All that is actually necessary for the practice of law is a good grasp of English and the instruction necessary to use the indexing system to find what you want. English comprehension you should have learned in high school. This book will teach you the indexing system and a lot more. All right? And it's 200 pages. Right, and they go hard. Let's just read this article right here in the National Law Journal, Monday, January 26, 1981. Studying law as a science. A 50-year-old political science professor from Michigan State University says he's attending the University of Michigan Law School so he can do consulting work for attorneys who try cases before the U.S. Supreme Court. Harold J. Spaeth, S-P-A-E-T-H, says he decided to go to law school after nearly 20 years of using computer analysis to predict the outcome of Supreme Court cases. Mr. Spaeth, who believes the personal attitudes of judges influence their decisions far more than do legal theories, specializes in looking at the voting records of the Supreme Justices. His predictions have reportedly been 93% correct during the past 7 years. My approach makes me something of an iconoclast in the legal profession, says Mr. Spaeth, who expects his Juris Doctor in December. My empirical data show that the touted reliance of the legal profession on rational theory is pure myth. Mr. Spaeth said justices usually pick the precedents and legal theories that will support the conclusions they wish to uphold. These legal theories, he said, serve to mask the underlying attitudes of the judges. All right, so they got little articles in here and sample documents of suits and question and answers and things of that nature, right? So, and just so you have a idea of the contents, table of contents, introduction, how to use this book, how to sue, self-defense, reading the law, who made the rules, making a judge behave, the appeal, laying the groundwork, breaking the system. Appendix, original document reproductions, miscellaneous index. Right. And also two other great titles available by Michael H. Brown, invisible weapons of the modern day ninja, bloody iron, Brown's alcohol, motor, fuel cookbook, Brown's book of carburetors, how to build a junkyard still, alcohol distillers handbook, hardback. Right, so you could just look up Michael H. Brown. Alright. Next up. Everybody's boy. The Biggest Secret. The book that will change the world. David Icke. Everybody's boy. Right. Page 352. According to Egyptian legend, the theme again, right? Always bringing up Egypt, right? Osiris was murdered by Set, and Set was killed by Horus, who lost an eye in the process, hence the Eye of Horus. For me, it also symbolizes the reptilians, right? For him, it symbolizes the reptilians. Looking into this world from the lower fourth dimension, and if you look at the magnification of the eye in figure 8, you will see the skin texture even looks reptilian. The 33rd degree Freemason and Black Nobility President, Franklin D. Roosevelt, had this symbol printed on the dollar bill from 1933. It was a symbol of secret societies in Europe long before anyone heard of the United States, and it is awash with Freemasonic and secret society symbolism dating back to the ancient world. The number of states in America at the time of independence, 13, was no coincidence. 13, the sacred 12 and 1, is an ancient mystical number, as we have seen throughout this book. On the two sides of the Great Seal, you find 13 stars above the head of the eagle. The motto E Pluribus Unum has 13 letters, as does Annuit Coeptis. The eagle holds 13 leaves with 13 berries in its right talon, and 13 arrows on the left. There are 72 stones, another mystic number, on the pyramid, arranged in 13 rows. The eagle evolved from the symbol of the phoenix, the sacred sunbird of the ancient Egyptians and Phoenicians, and the Native Americans' version was is the thunderbird. Right? Manly P. Hall says that the original seal included the phoenix, and it is known that one design for the Great Seal submitted by William Barton in 1782 included a phoenix sitting on a nest of flames. The symbol of the Scottish Rite of Masonry is the double eagle with a head looking in both directions, the symbol of Nimrod. The same symbol appears in at least two portraits of George Washington. The eagle is a widely used brotherhood symbol, and it can be found on the coat of arms of many countries, including Egypt, Libya, and Iraq. It was a major symbol for the Nazis in Germany, and it appears in the designs of pulpits and lecterns used by the Christian Church. Seals like the one used on the Great Seal of the United States can be traced back to at least 4000 BC in Egypt, Babylon, Assyria, and India. Our old friends, in other words. The first English royal patent seal was that of Edward the Confessor, who ruled between 1042 and 1066. This became a model for all future British and American seals. The Latin words above and below the pyramid on the Great Seal dollar bill announced the arrival of a new secular order. The New World Order is the insider name for the Brotherhood agenda, and George Bush used the term profusely when he was president. The date written in Latin in the bottom of the pyramid, 1776, is thought understandably to relate to the American Declaration of Independence in that year. But something else happened on May 1st in the same year of 1776. A very significant strand in the Brotherhood network was officially launched, called the Bavarian Illuminati, by the German professor Adam Weishaupt. This was quite a year for the Brotherhood, because also in 1776 the House of Rothschild was founded, and the Brotherhood controlled economists from Scotland. Adam Smith published his highly influential work, The Wealth of Nations. Weishaupt was trained as a Jesuit, the Society of Jesus. The founder of the Jesuits, the Spaniard Ignatius Loyola, formed a secret society within this apparently Catholic order, and the initiates were called Alumbrados, Alumbrados, the Enlightened, the Illuminated. Weishaupt created 13 degrees of initiation in his Illuminati, the same as the number of levels in the Great Pyramid, and the key personnel were to be found in the top 9 degrees. Right? So when we look at this, right, we have to come to our own conclusions based on the hard facts, opposed to people's assumption. Right now, at the bottom of this seal right here, right, it says the Great Seal there. So if it says that this is the Great Seal on the seal, why are these so-called conspiracy theorists claiming this is the Great Seal when this is of the United States, right? Of the United States, the Great Seal. So this is really the head or the obverse, and this is really the reverse, right? This is really the obverse, and this is really the reverse. The conspiracy theorists are going to tell you that this is the obverse and that this is the reverse. Why are they going to tell you that? Because the obverse is your birthright, right? We told y'all the obverse is circle 7, the shadow making the 7 in the circle. This is what is symbolized on this note, that again, these so-called conspiracy theorists call a dollar when a dollar is gold, not paper. All right. So keep in mind that in your pocket, you have the Great Seal that no one uses, because no one has authority to use it unless they're improper person and are Aboriginal and Indigenous to the Americas. And if you go into the temple, go to the Morris Science Temple and go look on the charter, and you're going to see the Great Seal on the charter, which is why Noble Drew Ali said that we're part and parcel, not partial, P-A-R-T-I-A-L, but P-A-R-C-E-L. Because this not only the Morris Science Temple or the Moorish movement, but also the United States of America is our government. One of them's domestic, one of them's national. And we have claim in both of them to shut down this European that's a foreigner and exercising judicial and executive powers in a land that he doesn't have any jurisdiction in. All right. And that was the biggest secret, David Icke. Right, so we're starting to pick it up a little, you know, we got the last 20 minutes right now. So next, Borger, Texas News Herald, Sunday, November 11th, 1962. And this is one of the greats. Behold a Pale Horse by William Bill Cooper. Right. Islam to the Moors in the chat. Forgot to click so I could see what y'all are saying over there. Page 243. Replying to your letter October 12th, also challenged for November 1961, quoting Patrick Henry on treaties. In the first place, Patrick Henry was and is no authority on either treaties or the Constitution, and he opposed, if it is too late to do anything about reinstating our Constitution, then why not just accept the traitorous UN Charter Treaty without more ado? Why didn't the American revolutionists think it too late or too difficult to defend their liberty? And if the highly intelligent framers of the Constitution were well aware of the death trap incorporated in Article 6, why then did they so frame it? Did they not expect patriots, rather than treasonous, as our elected officials, to honor and enforce the spirit letter and intent of the Constitution? I note you say that according to a law dictionary, the terms legal and lawful are almost one and the same. Agreed, quote unquote, almost, but not quite. I believe there is a fine point of difference. Taking us into the UN may seem to have been done legally by the President and Senate, but the act is still unlawful because it is unconstitutional, and the Constitution is the supreme law of the land. All renowned and genuine constitutional experts such as Thomas M. Cooley, Thomas Jason Norton, and Harry Atwood, to name several, have always held that anything which contravenes, diminishes, or perverts the Constitution is null and void and of no effect. Neither the President or Senate has authority or power to change, diminish, or destroy the Constitution by usurpation, treaty, or otherwise. Only a constitutional amendment can lawfully change it. The Constitution is a contract that we, the people of the USA, made with another, which sets up the machinery of government to carry out this contract, mainly for the purpose of protecting individual rights as well as state rights against the powers of government. And no public official has a right to override the provisions of that contract. To quote Thomas Jason Norton's Constitution of the United States, its application, etc., a law of Congress, to be one of the supreme laws, must be made in pursuance thereof, and not in conflict with the Constitution. When not made in pursuance thereof, it is of course unconstitutional and of no effect. And the same would similarly apply to a wonderful decision rendered by the Supreme Court or an unlawful treaty. And from Norton's Undermining the Constitution, which quotes Alexander Hamilton, number 33 of the Federalists, it will not, I presume, have escaped observation if it expressly confines the supremacy to laws made pursuant to the Constitution. And from page 21, the general government can claim no powers which are not granted to it by the Constitution, and the powers actually granted must be such as are expressly given or given by necessary implication. Anyone with the presumed intelligence to be President of the USA must know that he cannot lawfully make any such far-reaching treaty with the United Nations or any other foreign power as you envision by your language, without laying himself open to the charge of treason under Article 3, Section 3 of the Constitution. Just ordinary common sense is required to know that our alleged treaty with the UN and acceptance of an all-inclusive terms of its charter by our presidents, beginning with FDR, who connived with Stalin at Yalta for the setting up of the UN in the USA, and our Senate, is a violation of their sacred oath of office as per Article 3, Section 2 of the Constitution. Such a treaty makes a mockery of any genuine allegiance to our flag and Constitution. A genuine American, Abraham Lincoln, said, "Worse than traitors in arms are the men who, pretending loyalty to the flag, feast and fatten on the misfortunes of the nation." Think of any truth more applicable to the present time? A number of our officials, including former Secretary of State Dean Acheson, the late John Foster Dulles, and members of our present One World Kennedy entourage, go along with the statement that the USA now has no domestic affairs. There has been a melding of our domestic and foreign affairs. Meld means to merge. Katanga Province in the Congo thought she had some private affairs and rights, but the UN soon disillusioned her. Quote from SL Tribune for September 14, 1961. UN soldiers to take over Katanga. UN troops seize Katanga's capital, Elizabethville, in a brisk battle Wednesday, and the Congo's central government proclaimed the return of that secessionist province. There is no doubt that the President of the USA and Senate have surrendered certain of our rights and sovereignty to the UN and plan still more. Any informed American is aware that Article 4, Section 4 of the Constitution automatically cancels out any allegiance to the UN and its alien one-world internationalism, the antithesis of constitutional Americanism founded on Washington's no foreign entanglements, and that said Republican representative form of government is the exact opposite of the UN's charter's Soviet-initiated modifications, restrictions, and reservations in its various conventions, which would nullify our Bill of Rights. Stalin, his protege, Alger Hiss, and Russian communist Pulaski figured largely in the writing of the UN Charter. To assume that a heterogeneous body composed of appointed representatives of foreign governments, some from crude cannibalistic so-called states and others from virulently atheistic communist states, which governments do not represent, we, the American people, could exercise dictation and control over U.S. is monstrous in the extreme. Lawfully or constitutionally, they may not enforce any provisions of the UN Charter against us or take any action whatever affecting the sovereign rights of American citizens. Further, the United Nations is not a lawful government in the accepted sense of the term, and is not a proper body with which to make a treaty. Actually, the UN has no valid binding treaty-making power, except as the subversive one-worlders try to make it so. Quoting Norton's Constitution of the United States, page 14, a treaty is a written contract between two governments, not a motley assembly of unstable tribes or enslaved people calling themselves a government. Respecting matters of mutual welfare, such as peace, the acquisition of territory, and defining of boundaries, the needs of trade, rights of citizenship, etc. And such treaties, even though legally made, may be abrogated for cause. A treaty made pursuant to the Constitution becomes a part of the law of the land and should be honored, but it does not become supreme or take precedence over nor supersede the Constitution. It is not the law of the land standing alone, and no treaty or executive agreement is binding on the USA if made by the President alone, as has been done, with the advice and consent of the Senate, nor if it violates the Constitution. Actually, Article 6, instead of setting treaties on high or being a death trap, is a statement of the supremacy of the Constitution and of the national government. Lawful treaties are a part of, but subordinate to, the Constitution, for the simple stated provision therein that all laws and treaties must be made in pursuance thereof. Can the creature or a part become greater than its creator or the whole? Some American common sense is necessary in all this blather about the supremacy of treaties, which is promulgated largely by the one-worlders to discredit or diminish the Constitution so they can achieve their own ends. The language and intent of the Constitution and of Article 6 is clear and forthright, and does not admit in good faith of any other interpretation. But sadly enough, it is well known that many of our highest judiciary and elected officials in this era of treason, not reason, do not act in good faith nor in pursuance of the Constitution. And there's more, but we'll stop there. Right? And again, behold a pale horse. Right? William Bill Cooper. And you could also look him up online. I think there he has the lecture should be online, I think. Behold a pale horse. Right? And lastly, we got about 10 minutes. Right? Montauk Book of the Dead, Peter Moon. All right, and we just want to put this on the record. Library of Congress cataloging in publication data. Moon, Peter. The Montauk Book of the Dead by Peter Moon, 456 pages. ISBN 978-0-967-8162-34. 1. Biography and autobiography. 2. Religion. 3. Moors. Library of Congress control number 200-592-1593. And we're just putting that out there for the new people that are coming into this information. The Library of Congress is today close to one of the biggest libraries in the world, right? So if something's in the Library of Congress, that means that it's accepted as truth, right? If something's in the Library of Congress, that means that Congress is taking, or the Library of Congress is taking the position of giving validity, let's say, to whatever is housed in the Library of Congress, right? And then if you want, what you could also do is contact the Library of Congress, right? But we'll put it out there. 202-707-6787. So make sure you contact the Library of Congress and ask them about CM Bay and all of his filings in there, and the history of Moors in there, and what kind of books they have on Moors in the Library of Congress, and is Montauk Book of the Dead in there, and all that, right? So we can hear for ourselves, because when we call them, it's a different perspective, right? So you call them and you ask them whatever questions you want about the Moors, validate what information they have in the Library of Congress. And hearing it for yourself should either give you inspiration to get down with this and continue harder, or it's gonna inspire you to continue on this because you already been on this, and really now take this serious, because if it's in the Library of Congress, then you know that they back it, you know that they know. And it's not a thing of, you know, like when people bring up the examples of, well, the European doesn't respect Moorish whatever, that's why Malachi York got locked up, because they don't respect the Moorish whatever. They don't respect it if you don't respect it, right? If you don't appreciate what Nobuju Ali brought back to you, if you don't appreciate what your ancestors did, don't expect anybody else to appreciate you when you're talking, because majority of this information is vibration and frequency. This information isn't, you know, oh, I read that, so now I know. No, this information is becoming the knowledge. This information is mastering fruition. Right? You're gonna go out there, right? And you're gonna go to chapter 7 of the Holy Quran of the Morris Science Temple, right? Mastering fruition. It's not about believing and having faith in anything. It's about knowing, right? And Europeans know. Do you know? Because they already know. They already built Library of Congress and they're housing everything that they know, which includes the history of the Moors, not only in the world but also in America, right? So this is on page 401. I think we might have read this before, but I don't think we went too far in. But let's see what Peter Moon, the European, has to say about the Moors. Chapter 57, The Mars Gate. Asking people to remember their so-called past lives without any preparation or orientation is asking a bit much. In Scientology, this is called too steep a gradient. The general person can, however, tap into history by tracing the etymology of certain words and word meanings. In this chapter, I will trace the Moorish heritage by this method and let the relative truth speak for itself. In history, one of the most famous yet obscure characters to occupy the area adjacent to the Moor's Gate was known as a French gentleman, sometimes alluded to as a nobleman by the name of Hugh de Payens. H-U-G-H-D-E, we already know D-E's D-A-Y, day, right? Payens, P-A-Y-N-E-S. He is generally accepted to be the first Grand Master of the Knights Templar. According to historical texts, the Payens received his title from King Baldwin II, the Crusader King of Jerusalem. This was only, however, after 9 previous poor knights of Christ worked their way into King Baldwin's favor. Subsequently, a delegation of these knights was sent to receive sanction for their order from the Pope. Hugh de Payens arrived at the Vatican soon thereafter and received the full enthusiastic endorsement of the pontiff. He is believed to have completely ignited a wonderful spirit of enthusiasm in the Christian world and across Europe. Noblemen and royalty were said to compete to see who could give his order the better treasure. All in all, whether good or bad, the Knights Templar were the hottest show in town for a considerable number of years. History offers more questions than answers about Hugh de Payne. Recent years have given way to much misdirected and sophomoric enthusiasm concerning the Knights Templar, but there is plenty of historical evidence to suggest that he and his knights learned their craft from the Moors. Their only writings and legacy, if you read them closely, are based utterly and completely on a Moorish heritage. Popular thought attributes most of their Islamic heritage to Hassan Sabah and his assassin cult. There has been considerable misinformation on Hassan Sabah, H-A-S-S-A-N-S-A-B-B-A-H. And while I do not mean to minimize his influence on the Templars, you can also find historical connections to the Moors if you look hard enough. Hassan Sabah was, after all, initiated in Morocco. Common history, however, tends to list these connections as fragmentary at best. As the Knights Templar stem from Moors and begin their advent on the world seen under Hugh de Payens, I thought it would be interesting to study his history, but there is a scant mention of it. The etymology of the name Hugh de Payens, however, tells you far more than you would find in common history books. This, coupled with the synchronicity of him being a former resident of the Moors Gate area, opens an entire panorama to Moorish history that one might otherwise miss. The most mundane explanation of his name suggests that he came from the Champagne district of France and that his name Payne derived from Pagny, or Payne, whatever, a diminutive of Champagne, P-A-G-N-E, so Payne. This might even be true, but there are very intriguing connections when you consider the different and more pure strains of the etymology. What really made me pay serious attention to his name occurred when I was studying the prospect of Moorish presidents of the United States. Although I could find only the most nominal of ties to the Moors in common history books, the genetic lineage of many of these early presidents, including Washington himself, was more commonly tied to the Huguenots. Not being too sure what a Huguenot was, I readily found out that it was a carefully constructed term that the Moors hid behind for purposes of safety and political expediency. Common history states that the Huguenots were Protestants from the south of France who became a thriving force in the 1500s, after the Inquisition began forcing Jews and Muslims to convert to Christianity. Most of these Huguenots were Moors and Cathars who were seeking to escape the purge of the Catholic death machine that was waging successful war against any rival thought forms. Scholars are not really too sure where the name Huguenot came from, but it is generally accepted that the term is derived from the proposition that the early Huguenots used to meet at the gate of King Hugo, a legendary king who is hard to pin down. There was a King Hugo in Italy, but no one is quite sure that this is the same King Hugo. In investigating, I could not help but notice that the word Hugo is very similar to Yugo, as in Yugoslavia, which means southern slave. In this sense, King Hugo could be construed as southern king, which implies a Moor such as Othello. When we consider that Hugh de Payne's represents the deepest secrets of the origins of the Knights Templar, it becomes obvious that any group of Cathars and Moors from southern France would be honored to refer themselves as Huguenots. It is also something of a necessity as far as keeping the secret tradition of their belief system alive. Even common historians are pretty much starting to accept that the Knights Templar came to America before Columbus, but they have always recognized that the Huguenots were the first Europeans to build a European city in America. This was right near St. Augustine, just a year or two prior to the Spanish settlement. St. Augustine has long been recognized by common history as the oldest European city in the United States of America. The Spanish mission to St. Augustine was, however, for the express purpose of wiping out the Huguenot or Moorish contingent right next door. The Spanish were successful. While it is impossible to say outright at this time that the name Huguenot derived from Hugh de Payne's, it is certainly a logical conclusion, particularly when you consider the secret ciphers that the Moors have used throughout history. It seems to be a right trail. However, because other intriguing prospects present themselves when we further examine the etymology of the name Hugh de Payne's can be translated as Hugh de Payne or Hugh de Paganus. Hugh means spirit or mind, and the comparative etymology of the word Hugh cannot be dismissed either. While Hugh popularly means color or gradients of such, its absolute definitions are complexion and appearance. The etymology of Hugh breaks down to the sweetest word, high, which means skin or complexion. Since black people were always signified as people of color, it gives us pause to wonder if Hugh de Payne's was a dark Moor himself. There can be no dispute, however, about the fact that he considered himself a part of Moorish heritage. The Templars were created as a seed within the structure of the Catholic world and were designed to undermine it. The seed was planted by the arch enemy of the Catholics, the Moors. The plan worked for a considerable time period too. There is another definition of Hugh, which is listed as a separate word in the dictionary, and it means outcry in regards to the pursuer or clamor. The etymology of Hugh in this sense is hoot, as in to give a hoot or to make an outcry. When we consider the heritage of Hugh de Payne's, we must also recognize that in early English law, as per Webster's New Universal Unabridged Dictionary, there was a legal term called hue and cry. This referred to the pursuit of a felon or offender with loud cries in an effort to alarm the citizenry. The etymology for hue and cry is based on Anglo-French phrase hue et cri, As Hugh de Payne's came from France, this meaning has possible applications, particularly if you consider that his name was changed by history after his order became fugitives. Even if that is not the case, you will find that his name is pregnant with meaning and synchronicity of other respects. Right? And that was Montauk, Book of the Dead. Right? Montauk, Book of the Dead by Peter Moon. Right? So, today we have Montauk, Book of the Dead by Peter Moon. Right? You're going to do your research on Chapter 7, dealing with belief, faith, and fruition in the Holy Quran of the Moral Science Temple of America. W.B. Crow, A History of Magic, Witchcraft, and Occultism. Of course, Behold a Pale Horse, William Cooper. Orders of the Great Work, Alchemy, Manly P. Hall. Right. Oh, yeah, let me just. Copyright 1949. World's Living Religions, Jeffrey Parinder. History of Spain and Portugal, William C. Atkinson. Biggest Secret, David Icke. Brown's Lawsuit Cookbook. Michael H. Brown, the YMCA. Oh yeah, and just to go through some of these quick fast. So A to Z, right? Everywhere there's a YMCA in the world, right? A to Z. Angola, Argentina, Aruba, Australia, Bangladesh, Barbados, Belgium, Bolivia, Brazil, Cameroon, Canada, China, Colombia, Czech Republic, Denmark, Ecuador, Egypt, El Salvador, Fiji, Finland, Gambia, Ghana, Greece, Guatemala, India, Indonesia, Jamaica, Japan, Korea, Republic of, Latvia, Liberia, Madagascar, New Zealand, Nicaragua, Nigeria, Norway, Pakistan, Papua New Guinea, Peru, Philippines, Poland, Portland, Samoa, South Africa, Spain, Sri Lanka, Switzerland, Thailand, Trinidad and Tobago, USA, Venezuela, Zimbabwe, Zambia, and there was a lot that I left out, and then associate places and other countries where YMCAs are at work, you know, area organizations, Asia Alliance of YMCAs, European Alliance of YMCAs, Africa Alliance of YMCAs, Latin America and Caribbean Confederation of YMCAs, Middle Eastern Committee of YMCAs, International YMCAs, and then it breaks down every city, how many YMCAs are in the city or in the country, right? And last but not least, oh damn, forgot these ones. Book of Law, Aleister Crowley. Rights of Indigenous People, RV Bay Publications and MoorishGuidepost.com. The Thing That Ate the Constitution, Robert Anton Wilson, and here's more. Tell me why. Right? So that's it for today. Don't forget, tonight's blog talk is freestyle. So if you have any questions, just head over to Blog Talk, Moorish Heritage and History School, MHHS, Eyes Wide Open, right? And that's at 9:30. So once again, we want to say Islam to all the Moors online. Big up yourself. You already know that, you know, we can't do it without the support. I see the today I think was like one of the record shows, one of the record classes. We got about 16, 17 people back and forth tonight. So Islam to all the Moors online. Islam to all the Moors that's active and continuing to do the work that needs to be done. Because, you know, if it wasn't for y'all, you know, if it wasn't for you active Moors out there, none of us would even know what's going on or even have be able to consider the Prophet Noble Drew Ali, right? So we're going to close out with the prayer. And I don't know what's going on this weekend. Actually, it's Thanksgiving's coming up. Thanksgiving. So it's Thanksgiving weekend coming up in Canaan land. So we'll see what's good. We'll be given the knowledge. So five on the left, two on the right. Allah, the Father of the universe, Father of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. Allah is my protector, my guide, and my salvation by night and by day through His Holy Prophet, Noble Drew Ali, Islam. Peace to all the Moors. Peace, fam. You already know how we do it. And we'll connect again soon. Islam.